Welcome to another episode of From the Music Store on WBNJ in Barnegat, New Jersey, a community-supported radio station.
If you had the option, the power through science and technology, which actually we do have this power, we just don't do it, to bring back one musical icon from the dead through the use of DNA engineering to spawn an army of musical warriors, which I don't know why you need musical warriors, but who would it be? And there's no correct answer to this, but I'm just curious.
Oh, man. That's like the whole, you know, who'd you want to have a dinner with, if living or deceased?
Well, it's like the whole marry, sex, kill thing. There's no right answer on any of those.
Oh, man. Ah, oh, geez, I don't really know.
Yeah, one guy to bring back. And now bear in mind, the future of humanity could hang in this. When you have one chance to resurrect a musical icon to set the world straight again, culturally. No pressure.
Both of these guys talked about the same thing, and I hate that they came from relatively the same era, because you could go further back, because anybody comes from further back might have something even better to say about living simply. But it's a toss-up for me between John Lennon and Jimi Hendrix.
Pretty sure I knew John Lennon was coming.
Yeah.
Jimi Hendrix, I don't know.
I mean, he had a lot of really great, again, if the things that Jimi Hendrix said would get, if woke culture heard him, they would look at him as being passe. In the same way they view Martin Luther King, what he says, passe, but he had a lot of great things to say and how music kept people together and how it's like we're all down here together and we need to make the best of it. And you know, he greed is what's driving the world.
Oh,
it's got to stop and all that kind of stuff,
okay,
you know?
So you went more with the metaphysical part. I was thinking the actual music itself.
Oh, the music
like,
itself.
Like, what am I arguing? Like, we'd have to bring Bach back. Because
I get what you're saying.
But
okay,
I like the angle you went with.
In that regard, well, you know what? I mean, people fantasize all the time about what would he have done. I mean, people. Okay, so I've been part of that the Ray Vaughns, the Buddy Holly tribute band, and people ask me all the time, what do you think Buddy would have done had he not died? And I always say the same thing. Out of the three guys that were on the plane, the Big Bopper, I'm not so sure what he would have done. I don't know. I hate to say it, faded into obscurity. Ritchie Valens, I think, was poised to become a phenomenal lead guitar player. He was pushing the bat as a young 17-year-old kid. He takes all his guitar solos on every one of his songs, and you can hear he's like, he wanted to be a good guitar player. Buddy endured so much So many hardships in the recording studio and with the legality of music, with Norman Petty stealing the rights and giving himself writing credits and stealing Buddy's money by basically suggesting let's move the microphone over. Okay, I get a writing credit.
Right.
I think Buddy would have opened up or became a producer and opened up started his own record label. And he would have made sure that artists were taken care of and treated fairly.
He would have fostered a lot of great music.
Yeah, that's right. And people say the same thing about, like, when you listen to people even more current, like Stevie Ray Vaughn, where was he going? It's like, I heard him going into like a jazz world. You could hear it in his playing. Where would Hendrix go? I mean, with the age of all the things that happened after Hendrix's passing, because he was pushing the envelope of what was happening sonically. It's like, where would he have taken the guitar sonically? What would even come up in the studio?
I'm just going to put this hat on just for the sake of the conversation. It's not that I firmly believe this or anything. It's just more to evoke a response from you. If Jimi Hendrix hadn't existed, I think we still would have had a Jimi Hendrix, or a guitar still would be kind of where it is today. At the time when he came out, it was revolutionary, and he like blew a lot of doors open and influenced a lot of players. But looking back, it doesn't seem so... Maybe just because it's now part of the culture. It doesn't seem that groundbreaking now because it set the stage for so many people. But, like, you know, Led Zeppelin and Jimmy Page, they were already on track prior to the Jimmy thing. He really gets the credit as the godfather of rock guitar. But would we still have... I think we probably still would have had that.
I think because he sang and played at the same time, you could say, you can argue that Led Zeppelin was a three-piece with a singer. But there were things that Jimmy brought into the rock world that crossed over. Many people don't know, but he played guitar before he was obviously Jimi Hendrix, and he played in the Isley Brothers.
I know you like to dance, oh, but I give somebody else a chance. I'd like to express myself. Get back, you're ruining my health.
So, and then he's also doing a couple other things before that too, playing in R&B and like Motown type groups. And he brought a particular style that wasn't found. And would someone have done it? Probably. But when you talk to people who definitely are at the forefront of what we know as rock guitar and people like who you don't realize that you've heard a lot, people right. like Steve Cropper, Motown and R&B, people like Cornell Dupree, there were things that they were doing that was indicative of that style, but not indicative of rock and roll. And Jimmy brought those things with him into the rock scene.
So just so we don't blow past it for listeners, go back to those other two players. Can you, so we can maybe play a little bit, can you identify any of those songs that people might know or styles that put in a context?
Cornell Dupree did things that were like Rainy Night in Georgia. He did this real pretty type rhythm guitar playing stuff that you hear like maybe something like...
Why is that reminding me of a David Bowie song? Little China Girl. I think that's sure. like the same line out of...
But then you have what the Motown stuff was doing. Like they were doing this real, real fun stuff. Like and they had these little,
which for our non-music listeners, we would call those hammer-ons.
Hammer-ons and double stops. But you had Hendrix was doing that very same stuff because he came from that world of doing it, and all of a sudden he brings it into rock land. And that's gotcha. Where you get like When the Wind Cries Mary, when he goes he had this little
right,
and that was really part of the formula of what Motown had going for it and what R&B had going for it. And Motown did it with like the three guitar players. They had one guy playing one part, one guy playing another part, and a third person probably playing some kind of like almost doubling the bass kind of a thing.
Right.
So he brought those into the rock world and it hadn't been done before. So it's hard to say. It's definitely hard to say because we have so much great music that has been inspired by Jimi Hendrix and you can totally tell when you hear it. So it's hard to say.
Question, are we failing the Jill test right now? I think we just failed.
Probably.
I think we failed the Jill test.
Yeah, all of my wife has heard me talk about this stuff so many times.
So why don't you tell our listeners tell our listeners about the Jill test.
Well, that's my wife. And, you know, bless her heart, she's endured.
And not a Texas bless your heart.
And being from Texas is fun because, we're just a special bunch. And we will listen to your problems. We will. We will. I mean, we have a heart for you. And if you've ever heard a Texan say to you, bless your heart, bless you, what we're really saying to you is you're so stupid.
Not a Texas bless your heart. I mean a sincere...
Jill, yes, just say.
Sincerely, bless her heart, because she has heard me go off... And basically just had to listen to me talk about whether it's a piece of musical gear or a musical idea that's very specific. And she just sits there and she lends me her ears.
Jill, are you still there? Jill, wake up. Time to go to bed. All right.
There's an app. It's called Reverb. It's basically, for all those who don't know, it's the eBay for musical gear. So you can make a bid, you can make an offer, and you can get some pretty good deals. And they're really good with their social media marketing. They have news stories and this, that, and the other thing. But they'll flood my inbox and flood me with notifications of things that are a hot item. as if it thinks I have the time or income to support or even want to get this. But for all those who don't know, there's a man, his name is Les Paul, and he was a great guitar player. He, Les Paul and Mary Ford, for all those who don't know, were a duo back in the late 40s into the 50s, and they kind of hung it up a little bit when rock and roll moved in, but he created the Les Paul guitar, which famously was put out by Gibson Guitars. Now, there were only 600 units that were made in 1959. So between 1958 and 1960 are known as the burst years. This funky color of the Les Paul came out. Well, they're very valued, and they're only valued for a particular reason. It's because of the players who played them.
Okay.
And right now, there's a 1959 Les Paul that Reverb has so graciously let me know that it's up for sale if I want to get it, Jason.
How much?
It's just about $500,000. Do you think a piece of wooden strings is worth $500,000?
I mean, so there, personally, no, because I feel like I could put 10 kids through college doing that,
right,
and that would serve humanity better than me owning this instrument. It's the same thing like with Jerry Garcia's guitars went for a ton of money. The Kurt Cobain guitars, these are not regular people that own these things. These tend to be like hedge fund managers and like, you know, people that have either built businesses or tech people that have a lot of money. And more often than not, those instruments actually end up in a display case, which begs the question, is it worth anything if it's never even played?
Right.
Like the violinist who spends $1 million and tours the world and plays Carnegie Hall and people hear that instrument, and she or he generates enough revenue to support the expense of that instrument in service of the instrument, I think is one thing. If you're going to buy it because you have that money and you want to like walk around like you got a big piece of manhood and say, look, I got this guitar and it's a case and you're smoking cigars, drinking the most expensive scotch in the planet. I guess if that makes those people happy that they can buy it, but I'm going to say you're probably not going to see any of those Les Pauls being used. Speaking of which, it's funny. Last night on the deck, I was watching a video of him and his wife doing Alabama Bound.
Mm.
I'm Alabama Bound. We don't need your TV's hanging around. Just gave the meanest ticket man on earth all the world. Put the Jimmy's in and out.
What a great guitar player that man
wonderful.
Was. But I mean, things have market value. It doesn't matter. Cars, you know, like, and guitars and other paintings. You know, are paintings worth $10-15 million? I mean, people go to see the Mona Lisa, right, all the time. You can't even put a price on the Mona Lisa.
Mona Lisa, Mona Lisa, men have named you. You're so like the lady with the mystic smile.
I don't know.
I mean, you can almost argue that the Mona Lisa is only ever growing in value because every single day people pay money to see it. So collectively, and I guess
I think it's bigger than that. The Mona Lisa, and I think, is like supports
it has
Parisian
exponential
tourism.
Yeah, there's exponential value in that. Every day, every single day, people are paying good money to go and see it.
Yeah, I mean, I would gather if you said, "Hey, person, Paris, give me three words that say Paris," you would get Mona Lisa,
Eiffel Tower, and
a baguette.
Yeah.
Right.
Which is, I did one of those things when I was in France. So
a baguette?
I had a baguette.
How did you baguette the baguette?
I had a lot of wine.
Okay.
And you need something to soak up all that wine. So I went, I thought, is it...
Were you morning drinking? I thought baguettes were like some morning things, like you had them at breakfast or something.
Yeah, yeah.
One, two, three, here we go. Don't want to wait till the sun's sinking. We could be feeling all right. I know you know what I'm thinking. Why don't we do a little day drinking?
Well, Barry, actually, we're morning drinking.
Yeah, well, we were doing the cruise thing, and I was we pulled into port. We got off. It's like we're in France. We're going to make the most of it. So we got off and went to a restaurant, or I should say a cafe, and had some coffee, had some food, and ordered like 3 bottles of wine.
Because you're like, I've got some time. I'm here in France. When in Rome.
Yeah, exactly.
Except and then, you were in Paris.
Yeah, exactly. Actually, I didn't go to Paris. I forget where we were. I was going to go to Paris, but I had a baguette. And I'm like, right. Is it too touristy? But then I'm looking out the window of the cafe,
eating
and everyone's eating them. I'm like, this isn't a touristy thing. Everyone, who doesn't like warm bread?
Yeah. Oh, my wife likes the croque de mom or whatever. It's the ham and cheese little breakfasty sandwich they kind of do.
Yeah.
Wait, how
could you look up a picture of the Mona Lisa, or do you think you actually have to be there to see it? To really, you want to gaze upon its beauty? You think you have to be there?
Okay, so this I hope we don't lose audience members. I don't need to be there because it's a 2-dimensional work. I saw the statue of David in person, and that was impressive because you could walk around it and you could see it. A painting, I feel like 2-dimensional image, maybe, you know, that's a good question. I don't know.
Because we're about to step into the art world now in the art studio. So we obviously want people to come to the cafe that we're going to be running and check out the art that we have. And if there was a picture online, it's like, well, there we go. I saw it.
Art like the Mona Lisa, it needs to be. Well, you make a good question because like you could see it on the computer, but is it the same to see it live?
Right.
I had a good thought now.
Because it's much more expensive than just going and paying the admission price at the Louvre.
Is what more expensive?
What I'm saying is, first of all, where is Mona Lisa? It's in the Louvre, right?
I believe it's in the Louvre. Yeah.
Okay, so if you're not from Europe, you can't take a bullet train. You got to fly, and you got to get a hotel. So this is way more expensive than just the price of the ticket to get into the museum where it is.
That's what I'm saying. The painting itself is supporting like tourism to a country.
Right.
It is part of the reason why people go to Paris besides the baguette.
Right.
and morning drinking, apparently, if you're Jeremy Renner.
I went there for free.
Why that says that the morning drinking is okay, I have no idea, but okay.
No, I mean, is it worth it to me? I mean, I would imagine you're going to go into whatever country to go do a lot of other things, not just that. But if you said to yourself, it's on my bucket list, I got to see this thing before I die, then that's what it comes down to. The fact that it's just survived as long as it survived is enough of a reason to go see the real thing, that it's still here.
Yeah, exactly. Do you have any musical bucket lists?
I'm crossing one off my list.
Oh, you are?
This one is in a musical bucket list in terms of somebody I want to go see play their music. Going to see Brian Setzer. Brian Setzer, and he's a hero of mine, and I'm going to see him at the Count Basie Theater
in Red Bank, New Jersey.
In Red Bank, New Jersey, so that's big. It's a multifaceted question. Musical bucket list. I want to be able to get through either a piece inspired by or literally a transcription of something akin to either George Benson or Joe Pass.
Oh, yeah. Well, Joe Pass, was listening to something the other day, and they, I think it was Janis Larsson might have been making this comment that, like, sort of the advancement of jazz guitar sort of stopped with Joe Pass.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
And maybe he also mentioned John Scofield, I think, as well, that there was a point where, like, kind of the development of that style sort of paused, and it could be that because he was such a monster that, like, it's really hard to, like, now where do you go with that? I'm sure somebody will, but it begs the question, like, all right, what do you do after that?
Yeah, yeah. Pat Metheny is really great, and but, I mean, you can hear where Joe Pass crosses over, and maybe it's more electrified.
Yeah.
More, a little more distorted, so with that fusion kind of a vibe. But yeah, no, I can agree with that statement. As far as the progression of the actual jazz guitar goes, yeah.
Now, in the past, we've talked about music and food, right? And how, like, so Joe, I think Joe Pass is, like, if people that don't know him, like, put stream it. And, like, if you're having a dinner party or something like that, it's great music to put there.
Virtuoso is a perfect record to put on for a dinner party.
What are you having at that dinner party?
Personally?
Baguettes? Are you having French food? No, it's not French food.
No. Well, he's playing American jazz, so I think it goes good with, like, really classy American fare.
I think that album is one of the ones he would just walk into a studio with a band, and they'd be like, what are we going to do? Let's just play. And they would play. And it was not like now where bands pre-produce for 6 months, and then they get the programmer and the engineers and this 10 songwriters. You just walk in, pick up a guitar, right?
I mean, as far as virtuoso goes, it's him and his guitar, and that is it. There is no band.
Oh, there isn't.
So, how terrifying is that for a record producer or even a recording engineer? It's like, okay, well, I guess just do your thing.
Yeah. Look, I'm gonna hit record.
Yeah, I'm gonna go have a coffee and a baguette, an espresso.
It's
and a
10
baguette.
A.m. in Jeremy's case, a glass of wine.
That's right. So he's just flying. He's just doing his thing and. I think the same thing with Tommy Emmanuel, too. Although Tommy Emmanuel's done some collaboration records, and every once in a while he has a band and other instrumentation. But the records that he puts out that are just him by himself, I mean, Joe Pass did play an acoustic archtop as well as an electric archtop guitar. Yeah. But Tommy Emmanuel plays an acoustic fingerstyle guitar player. He walks in. They place the microphone in the right spot, and then they put their feet up after they push record, and they just let him go.
A lot of people, when they hear their voice, just in a recording, like, oh, I don't like the sound of my voice. And there's scientific reasons for that. You actually hear your voice in your head different than you do.
Right.
My daughter likes to tell me that all the time. For me, a bucket list thing, this would be like a good bucket list thing to accomplish, but one I am likely not to ever accomplish, is to do, much like Joe Pass, a solo album. Mainly because there's no reason to do so albums anymore. Albums don't exist. But could you just phrase this or put this in context for everybody? The difficulty for you to release an album of just you, and I'm going to add a component, singing and playing guitar or instruments, but let's just stick with guitar and voice, where you listen to 10 songs that you did of your own and can actually suffer through it.
Are there any other ears that are going to be like in the room just for me to bounce ideas off of, or am I also the only person who's going to be handling like the creating and maybe what ends up on the cutting room floor? Am I the only person in the room?
You could have 100 people in the room, but just to get there.
Okay. I don't know. I haven't tried it, and I don't know. I don't know. I think because music is a conversation, and how can you have a conversation with yourself?
Yeah, I've done things where I like to do a little demo. It's just me for one tune. That's fine. I couldn't listen to a whole record of
myself.
I don't
think so.
Hell no.
No.
That'd be very hard. But like Joe Pass walks in and he's plays, goes home, like goes, makes a ham sandwich. And
yeah, that's right. Yeah.
All right. So I think we got somebody in this door. So we have to take a pause. Okay. Well, don't bump in the microphone. Okay. So we're adding a new segment. It's going to be called What Are the Kids Listening To These Days?
That's so weird.
Yeah, I know, it is weird. So every morning in the summer, I drive my two girls to camp, and they take over the radio and DJ the entire ride, and I don't get to play my music, I have to listen to their music, which is good because they're keeping their father in tune with new music, right? So we had some new songs that we've been listening to this week, but you got to pick one. What is your favorite new song that we've been playing in the car ride?
Probably Don't Blame Me.
Don't Blame Me. And who sings that?
Taylor Swift.
Oh, really? It's always Taylor Swift. I thought, what about Ava Max? Weren't we doing an Ava Max tune?
Yeah.
But it's Don't Blame Me is Taylor Swift? That's the song? Okay, and why? What do you like about that song?
Well, I don't know. I just like the tune.
You don't know? You just like... What about you, Joes?
I don't know. I like it because me and my friends do it a lot, and then, like, I've learned most of the lyrics.
You learned most of the lyrics? Okay. All right, let's hear a little bit of that. You're making me keep listening to Taylor Swift. Ah! Hi. Thanks for listening to another episode of From the Music Store on WBNJ. You can catch replays of this show and all of our others at fromthemusicstore.com, WBNJ.org, and on all of the podcast platforms. Thanks a lot. We'll see you guys next week.